So if you've ever felt queasy after a roller coaster or had morning sickness during pregnancy or eaten something bad at a company picnic, you know that nausea and vomiting are terrible symptoms. So now imagine you've been diagnosed with a cancer. You're worried, you're probably tired and having some other symptoms. You're starting some anti-cancer therapy, and now you're developing those symptoms on top of everything else. It's something terrible for our patients to have to go through. So our group here has taken an interest in understanding radiation therapy-induced nausea and vomiting specifically, because compared to chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting, it's actually understudied and less well understood. So we think that radiation-induced nausea and vomiting are fairly common, but we don't know exactly how common they are. And that causes a lot of problems. One problem that we encounter daily in clinic is, what do we do as radiation oncologists to help our patients? And so anecdotally, we know that some people might do different things for the same sort of patient with the same type of cancer. But we weren't exactly sure how much variation in practice there was. And we felt that it would be important to try and quantify that amount of variation, and that's why we embarked on this survey study. So this is by far the largest study of its type internationally. Investigators from 16 countries contributed to the survey design and development. The survey itself was distributed in 12 of those countries, and we had cumulative responses from over 1,000 radiation oncologists. That every patient about to embark on radiation therapy has either a minimal, a low, a moderate, or a high risk of developing those symptoms because of their treatment. For a patient who's about to have treatment to, say, a leg or an arm, there aren't many underlying organs there, we would classify that patient as being at a minimal risk of developing those symptoms. Now, for a patient about to have radiation therapy that will also affect the upper abdomen, perhaps the liver, the stomach, we think that those patients are at a higher risk due to the role that those organs play in the development of those symptoms. What we found from the respondents was that for patients that we think are at a very, very high risk or a very, very low risk, the management recommendations were the same. But for patients who we think are at either a low or a moderate risk, somewhere in the middle, there was a lot of variation in practice and differences in what people recommended that we do. Now, interestingly, the majority of patients that undergo radiation therapy fall into those low and moderate risk levels. We think that a lot of the variation in recommendations has to do with the fact that we don't yet know how common these symptoms are exactly. And so what we recommend is that there be a number of observational trials that will follow cohorts of patients carefully, track their symptoms, and then we'll have very valuable data to base future recommendations on. That will help us sort of personalize our approach to symptom control. We spend a lot of time personalizing treatments, anti-cancer treatments. My dream would be to also personalize symptom control for everybody that receives radiation or chemotherapy.